Well, considering I moved very early age, you know, I was only 6 months old when I moved to France, you know, so I can't really be affected by the culture. You know, I had my parents and that was enough. As I say, I mean, like, as you can see, the French team, we just won the World Cup. You know, France is multicultural, you know, and there is a lot of African people living there, you know, from north to south, you know. So, yeah, it wasn't many different. You know, as a kid, you know, you don't know much, you know. You just see the people around you, you get on with it. You don't know what's white to black, what's black to white. You don't take any differences, you know. But, yeah, as you grow up, you start, you know, literally realizing that, yeah, maybe this is not my birth country, this is probably not my country, and I'm accepted, you know, but not fully integrated. My dad, obviously, is a big football fan, you know, he played himself, you know, not at the highest level, but he's a big football fan, and I remember we were supporting PSG, actually. We were in Paris, I was about 3 or 4 years old, and obviously he always take me out, you know, I was the first one, so he has to take me out to go and play and everything, and I started getting involved with all the people, starting playing and literally more kicking the chin than kicking the ball, you know. And yeah, and he went like, he seems to enjoy football, you know, and everything. And so he literally, at 4 years old, he just signed me into the local club, you know, the suburb, you know, of Noisy-le-Sec. Well, as every kid, you watch people play football, the stars and everything. And I was a big football fan, so remember every birthday was about football, football boots, balls, or football tape, you know, them big tape, remember them, you know, it's been a long time. So, and I remember I had Pelé, I had Maradona, I had Lothar Matthäus tape, I had like Frank Beckenbauer's, you know, I had the Italian tape, the Brazilian tape. My dad, like, every occasion will buy me tapes to watch football and everything, and literally fall in love, absolutely fall in love with football. But differently to being a fan, you know, I was more like someone who wanted to be like them. So I was looking at everything they're doing, you know, everything doing and thinking like, oh yeah, I need to do this. Yeah, I need to do this. I need to do this. And yeah, got involved more and more. And growing up, you know, everyone was saying I was talented, but I think I was just more physical than everyone else. You know, I grew up tall very quickly, you know, so from my age, I got literally put to the edge above because of my size. And then 2 years above because I was still bigger than everyone. And then from there, obviously, when you put in a situation where you got to play with all the people, you kind of learn quicker, you know, the roots, you know, to be able to compete with them. Mm-hmm. And that's really what happened for me. Yeah, it's, I went the hard way with the, you know, it's one of these things. I mean, obviously, my mom didn't want me to go to any football school until I was, you know, in an age where, like, I could literally look after myself properly. Mm-hmm. I remember Lance came in when I was 12 years old. My mom said, he's not going anywhere, he's too young. And obviously, my parents were really into, my mom was like, school, school, school. Forget about football. If you're going to make it, you will make it. But I want you to make sure that at school you follow the process at school. So it was like, if you don't literally study good, you're not playing football. Mm-hmm. It was like that. So it was a threat. And you know, when you love something, you work hard to get it. So yeah, so it works out well for me. But it's mainly when I was 16. When I was 16, I started at 15 playing in a third division in France with the adult team, Noisy-le-Sec. They put me in to because they had people missing. They say, all right, you're strong enough, we take you in. I was surprised because I was on the bench against a team called, let me try to remember the name. It's a Portuguese team, actually, Lusitanos in Paris. And it was a league game for Noisy-le-Sec. I was only 15, you know. I was there with the third division team. They weren't professional anyway in France. So I was there and I didn't expect coming in. And the last 30 minutes of the game, the manager said, come, you get involved. And that was the first time I was like, whoa, it was a bit of a shock because you're playing against adults and everything. Mm-hmm. But it was a good experience. And from there, obviously, we had interest from Bordeaux and Saint-Etienne. At 16, my mom thought, okay, you're an age now where, like, you know what you can do or what you need to do to carry on doing anything you want to do, really. Mm-hmm. So she let me go to Saint-Etienne. I chose Saint-Etienne over Bordeaux. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, 2 years after, I was, like, out of Saint-Etienne. was playing for Grenoble. We got promoted to the second division with Grenoble. I was playing there. It was good, you know, at a good time and everything. But the manager came to me. I was 21, close 22. He came to me and said, literally, you know, I'm going to sign all the players, you know, because I want to push again for the promotion. I was like, well, what's left with me? So, well, you'll be involved, you'll be on the bench, but you won't play as much as you played last season. And I went, okay, no problem, you know, obviously. But then, yeah, asking advice to all the generation of my team, you know, I spoke to them, saying, what should I do and everything. They all told me, like, you should carry on playing. You know, I had 2 years left on my contract. I decided to take a gamble. You know, I threw away my contract, left for England on trials, and it did work out well, actually. You know, like, at school, you learn English, you know, obviously, mm-hmm. it's just academic, you know, what you know, what you need to know mm-hmm. about English. But, yeah, it was difficult at first. You know, I had a 2 years transition before Reading to Brentford, you know, which is another London club. I was at Brentford for 2 years, you know, met some great people, start hanging out with them and start picking up the languages. Made a lot of mistakes at first, but they were cool, you know, nice enough to let me get away with it. Yeah. And then by the time I got to Reading, I could speak better English already, you know. 2 years down the line, I could already speak English and everything. Mm-hmm. So when I got to Reading, I fitted straight away, which was great. What do I remember? Well, obviously, we achieved something very special in 2006. You know, we got promoted, only losing 2 games in the season. You know, I think we hold 24 clean sheets, which for a defender is fantastic. Mm-hmm. You know, we scored 99 goals that season. You know, and we are the record holders of 106 points. You know what I mean? So I can't. Yeah, it's something that people will take time to beat. Wolves got close this season, actually. Wolves. But yeah, we wrote down this story. My name is on it. Yeah, of course, it makes you proud. You know, it's one of his things. We had me at the time. Then we had like all the players, like Emerson Fai, who came later on to join us. You know, and Sekou Baradji. Mm. You know, we also had Andre Biquet, who came to Reading after the year we got promoted and everything. But yeah, it was fantastic. You know, it's one of his things. We there to make history, you know, at least show the way to our younger generation, you know what I mean? And when you achieve something like that, you can only be proud of what you've done. I think, like, we are lucky. We're born with a presence, you know what I mean? We're athletic. We are, like, really, really good at physical sports, you know. The only luck we've got probably at first is tactical, you know, and, you know, understanding of the game and what to do and when to do it. That's probably why we're lacking a little bit, but I got educated in Europe, so I had that advantage, you know, to probably the African players who have grown up in Africa. I would say I was probably less gifted technically than the one here, but the brain, which, you know, literally got taught from the very young age how to understand the right way of playing football, because obviously here, you know, I've been in Uganda for a month now, you know, and it's been great. I've been watching football and everything, and I see some great talents, you know, technically, physically, they're on top, you know what I mean, very quick, skillful and everything. And then there is some moment in the game where you're thinking, why you done that? You're thinking, why you doing that? It's not logical, you know, and that's probably where, like, we're lacking a little bit in Africa. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to increase the coaching or improve the coaching, I will say, you know, so we don't make them mistakes who cost us later when we become pro. It was the right time for me to make history. It was the right time for me to achieve what I always wanted to achieve from the very young age. Mm. Been watching Man United, Crystal Palace. They were my favorite team when I was a kid. Mm. And obviously the like of Man City, Liverpool and Arsenal. You're like, wow, I would love to achieve that. One day play against them team or be into one of them teams. Mm. And things were going so well for me, so smooth. I mean, I played for Senegal under 21 and 23s. I captained them for 2 years, but that was the opportunity for me to make history and achieve what I wanted to achieve. So I thought I need to put my personal gain first before I can go to Senegal, mm-hmm. you know, because going to Senegal straight away, it probably would have been good, you know, but I would have not been the player I was at Reading if I had done that, and probably I would have not achieved what I achieved at Reading mm-hmm. if I had gone straight away. You know, I was a I was a key member of the team. The manager needed me. I mean, I remember having the conversation with Steve Koppel. He said, listen, they want you, but I need you. You know, literally said, it's not I want you to stay, it's I need you to stay. He said, if you don't stay, you know, the team, the balance of the team is going to be gone. You and Eva are working so well, but you're the main pieces of my of the puzzle. And if I don't have you, we might not go promoted. We were like behind Sheffield United, I think, at that time, you know, at Christmas. And I went like, I'm not ready. You know what I mean? It's just one of his set of mind. I mean, you go to Senegalese team, you had El Hadji Diouf, you know, like you had the big names, Salif Jones and everything. And I'm thinking, how am I going to be competing against them? They're all in the Premier League, playing for big clubs. I'm playing at Reading, we're in the second division, you know, championship. Mm-hmm. Going there right now will be, yeah, it will be great because I'm playing well. They might use me, they might not use me. Because at the time, you had Lamine Diatta, who was still playing. You had, what's his name, Suleiman Diawara, who was also there. So, you know, and yeah, you had Abdoulaye Faye. And they all like big players, big names in Senegal. So me going there, I would be like Nemo. Yeah, you know what I mean, in the big sea. Yeah. So I thought, all right, should I take the gamble, go to Senegal, or should I start Reading and take the gamble to get promoted? And then I'm at the same level as everyone, and I will expect to be treated the same way as everyone. And I chose to stay. Mm-hmm. I chose to stay, and probably that was probably the best decision I made. It's a big break, you know what I mean? Not only like England, there is no break during Christmas, but when we go to the African Cup, it's almost like our team is deprived of like two or three players at the time, you know. It might not affect so much in France because, you know, we got so many different nationality, African who are sometimes not qualified, sometimes qualified, but France is a big market. There is so many of us that we can't all get to the national team, so you compensate, you know, with that. But for teams like England who goes and get only the best in Africa, you know, like literally only the best in Africa, to lose the African player is a big loss. You know, when Sadio Mane got to leave Liverpool in January, club is like, hold on 1 minute, I'm not even sure if you're going to be back fit. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's a big miss for Liverpool to lose Sadio Mane and Mo Salah at the same time. Mm-hmm. You know, that's like the two key members of the team. It's almost like England decided to play the World Cup in January, and suddenly like you got all Harry Kane and all the players leaving. It wouldn't make sense for the league anyway. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it affected African players a lot. It did affect a lot. You know, when it comes to having big moves, we don't get enough big moves because of the situation, mm-hmm. because of that situation, the African Cup, and people thinking ahead. Okay, if I lose him, I've got to buy another player. I've got to compensate with him. All right, we better not have him. You know, and have some European players and leave them to later, you know. And but now in July, June, July, it will be perfect for African players to achieve their best in Europe. Into strikers' feet, you know, they can be in the air, they can be on the floor, and you got to go pass in front of them to get the ball, and they're not going to let you go that easy. Obviously, they're going to try to hold you or to back up on into you, so stop you from there. So if you got that strength going forward, you can always, you know, make the move out of the way, and literally then you got to get the right technique. I mean, you know, being there strong, you know, push forward, then get